it's, I think the technology to render them lifelike is already here. I think with Paul Walker, you saw it. I think the technology to move them lifelike is here. I don't think it'll ever be, like say if you bring Marilyn Monroe back, it's a star in a movie. It'll never be her, it'll be always an impersonation in some way. It'll maybe digitally looks exactly like her, but there's a performer that's gonna drive it, whether it's an animator or an actor who's motion captured. And that's a counterfeit in a way, you know. So I do think it will be, which we have seen in a lot of movies, but like digital makeup, and a very good digital makeup. So it's almost like right now they do a Hitchcock movie with Anthony Hopkins, and they make him look like Hitchcock. He doesn't look exactly like him because you can't completely change him. But you could have motion captured him and do a real digital Hitchcock that looks exactly like him. And then do you believe it's him through the performance? I don't know. It's interesting. It's definitely a question that's, you know, it's going to happen. It's happening already. So it's, but I don't know if it's ever really, people believe just because it's digital, maybe it's more realistic, but I think it's still an impersonation. It's somebody either acting or an animator bringing that life to the, you know, the performance to life. But by the way, I saw your film last night. It was great.
Oh,
Los Parasitos. Yeah. It was cool. Yeah, yeah. Very cool. If you guys haven't seen it, you should. Is there another screening?
No, it was the last one.
The last one? That was fun. Very Twilight Zone, which I love. I love Twilight.
Hello, Mr. Hovai. Glad to see you. I have enjoyed very much your speech. I have one similar question, like a gentleman. I was on the study Maya for about seven, 8 years ago into Belgrade. My professor was Peter Bakic. He works for, now he's on the art school in San Francisco, like coordinator, but he used to work on Star Wars at Double Negative.
Okay.
And he used to talk also about the scene when the ship goes
breaking,
broke,
yeah.
How it is made, because he talked to us through the Skype from Hollywood, straightly from LA, and brought us the newest reviews that he saw new about techniques and so. He went on the half of the year. And we asked him, someone from school asked him a question, how he see the tools for a modeling, for a rendering in the future, that was now for about 7, 8 years ago. And he said that then that it will be no big development. It will be only alive in one focus.
Hmm. Yeah, I think your question is how do we see the modeling developing in terms of digital modeling tools?
Yes, Maya modeling toolkits,
yep.
Rendering, focus like Arnold Katana,
yep.
It's a lot better about Ausmental Ray, for example, for a graduating work we could use it was for Biden in Mental Ray to use some lights. That was for Autodesk for Biden from their sites.
Yeah, okay. I think there's always advances in all of these technologies. You know, I think it's never gonna end in some ways, because right now we're seeing, you know, real-time rendering engines and ray tracing, which is quite, and every tool that's helping us make things look more real quicker is the key. Because for me, even with animation, it was always about the speed of the animation rig. So I don't know if many of you are animators, but you know, when you go to a company and the rigs are really, really slow, your animation suffers because you can only animate so many iterations and you gotta hit play blast and you wait for an hour and then you get to see it and you're like, okay, I wanna make just this little change and see if that worked, but I gotta wait another hour to see it. And, you know, so for me, it's always about making the rigs fast, and it's the same thing with rendering and modeling. It's all about making it fast and user accessible. And so the modeling tools, I think, are really good now. And even with the ship breaking apart back then, couldn't be done digitally. Today could actually look better.
I know.
Much better.
He explained us.
Yeah. There's many tools to break things apart and make it look very realistic. So.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you. I think I should go on to the next. Sam. Yeah.
I just want to ask a question. Sorry.
Sure.
What do people develop the special tools for you to rig the face? Like for you were talking about the muscles and the thickness of the skin. Did they something just for you?
Yeah, it's on Avatar we kind of used a it's kind of blend shape network, but it's like a really very sophisticated one where you're able to, you know, and it takes extremely talented modelers and people that can see the details. So I don't know if you guys heard of Jeff Unai, but he's like he's a good friend of mine who was a modeling facial lead on Avatar, and he's just so valuable to that film because he saw the details, he saw what it took to really get all the subtlety. And it was about, you know, he and I going back and forth about looking at shots and saying, we don't have this in the rig, we need this in the rig. And so it'd be constantly getting these, and he would get it right, he'd get all excited and give me a call and tell me to look at a new rig that he was publishing. But it really, you know, and then it was about keeping the rig small enough, because if you look at, say, Neytiri's face, she had 2,500 blend shapes. Wow. So, and that's, it's a ton. It's a, you know, way too many. If you had them all as individual sliders, the animators would lose their minds. So it would be impossible, actually, to animate. So, but we were able to consolidate that into the muscle movement. So each slider had a muscle name, essentially like what the muscle would do. But under the hood, it was activating many blend shapes. So it felt like you're controlling a muscle simulation, but it wasn't really just a lot of hard work.
The extra blend shapes were for like wrinkles and stuff like this, that's it?
Or extremes. So, or depending on isometric muscle movement, two muscles that counter each other or two muscles that pull together, all of it needed a different shape. So if you used three different muscles at once or four muscles, it would be a different shape. Seven muscles, a new shape, jaw open, a new shape. So it just quickly branched into, so the sliders, the main sliders that animators had was like 60 sliders to animate the face, to control 2,000 shapes. So I will switch to Jungle Book, which was my latest film. And it's kind of funny because in between Avatar and even during World War Z, I was kind of following a different path. I'm kind of now trying to pursue directing much more. And I was doing pitches around town. I have a few projects I've been writing and developing. And they're more genre-based, they're more sci-fi. It's one of my favorite genres. But funny enough, this project kind of came up as an opportunity. I got a call from Disney. And because it wasn't a facility-based, it wasn't at Weta, or it wasn't at MPC in London specifically, I was more hired by Disney. It became more interesting to me because I went, they wanted me to go talk to Jon Favreau and see what his vision was for the movie. And he and I really kind of had a good talk. I told him that I was really into directing and would rather do, if I get a call to direct, I'm going to have to leave Jungle Book. And he said, that's fine, let's do it. I want to have you involved anyway, because he was thinking I could really help bring realism to the animals, which is what he really wanted to do. And I think it was kind of a fun idea because it's a film that, obviously it's a loved animated classic from Disney, but when you look back at it, there's a very fun part about the movie, but the actual story itself isn't amazing. And it didn't really grab as much from the original material from Rudyard Kipling. And so when John told me they want to dig back into that material and bring some of the themes back in, and make it, you know, kind of a deeper story, I was like, that sounds really interesting. And, you know, bringing these animals to life on a, making them larger than life was really cool. So I think I just have a little quick little presentation. So the types, you know, the types of shots in this film, obviously you can see that, you know, the render quality is now way beyond even Avatar, in my opinion, because we're able to do realistic sense of light. So even Avatar had a fake lighting feel. Even if you go watch the film today, you'll kind of sense it. This one is doing real radiosity, bounce light, everything throughout the entire forest, everywhere, at all times. So it's because machines are so much faster now, and render times have gone down because they're just getting smarter about writing render software. So hard things are still, you know, fur simulation, and then you put the fur, thick, long fur, in water, and it gets even more difficult. So, you know, this. What's funny about this is the types of shots we had, harder and ridiculous. It's borrowing a quote from my producer at NPC, who kind of said it's really a show he's never done before at NPC, because it's really, you know, at most shows you kind of can say, oh, we have, you know, 30% of them are easy. We just give the, you know, and we really work on the hard ones. But this one was a challenge from start to finish on every shot. And really, we, you know, if you look at this frame, for example, that kid, Neil, said he was shot in a pool in a parking lot in Los Angeles. And it really was a blue screen pool. So all we really got from this was his face and his hair and maybe his shoulder. The rest of it, he's digital quite often. And a lot of his arm, his legs are digital throughout, because he's touching a lot of stuff, interacting. So we really, even if he wasn't digital, we had to have a digital version of him completely in that same pose, because he needs to cast shadow, he needs to interact with the fur. So we had a digital version of the hand doing exactly what Mowgli was doing. And sometimes we would just replace it anyway because it was easier and it integrated better. This is a typical picture of on set on the Jungle Book. But it's kind of funny because I look, me and the woman above Mowgli, is she's kind of an acting coach. And, you know, John is looking like pointing at a frame of kind of what we had done, was we prevised the movie in a very rough form, but it kind of gave us all a plan for how to make this film. And so John's kind of looking at what he really needs Mowgli to be doing in this performance based on our kind of template that we had already animated, and saying, you know, teaching him what he needs to do. His acting coach is listening, you know, thinking really closely what she needs to do to get him to perform. And the hardest part was this kid, you know, he's acting on a blue screen set, literally blue walls all around him. He's never acted before. And, you know, you're trying to get a genuine performance, like this kid is really in a jungle and these animals are right next to him. And so it was really, really tricky. And John had a great idea of having these performers, like these Jim Henson puppeteers, were on set all the time. They were wearing usually blue outfits or blue arm, and they'd have a little hand puppet. And the kid really kind of let go when he saw that. He kind of became a kid again. And he didn't think about everything else that was around. And he really got more natural performance out of that one call, which is really a brilliant stroke on John's part. This is kind of how our sets looked most of the time. You know, we had one object, maybe something for him to climb up on, and everything else blue. And then you can see he's replaced into a digital world. That's a lot of digital assets being built, as you can see, for one shot. You know, an NPC's plan of how to build this world was really quite good, you know, because we did this film faster than any other film of this undertaking. So Avatar took 3.5 years. This took about almost 2 years, but still under 2 years. Is amazing to reach this kind of level of immersion in a digital environment, completely digital, almost all the time. And so if you look, even the branch, you know, he's grabbing at was replaced, but it's a little bit darker up there. I'll show you another one. That's actually not a Henson puppet. The reason we use the bigger one is because a lot of times we had shadow interaction to deal with. So we would really try to make the shadows of, you know, whatever animal that's next to him kind of be on him, which helps seat him in the ground. So like Baloo, a lot of times we had a big people carrying a big cardboard cutout of Baloo to cast a direct shadow onto Mowgli. But you know, he did an amazing job. I don't know how many of you have seen Jungle Book. Yeah. Oh, cool. So you kind of, I have a little bit of footage, but so the research, you know, again, throughout my career, I think it's helped me a lot to do a lot of research and observation, and it's really something that, you know, I think is helping with pushing the envelope of realistic animation and realistic characters. The more you study real life, the better it is. And like I was saying before, you're finding a lot of things that you would never do as an animator, that you'd never think to do. And so, you know, studying all the body language of wolves and what they do and why they do it, you know, the ear movements, why and when they move, you know, how they kind of react to different members of the clan of wolves. It's all really, really fascinating stuff. And it's all, you know, we even brought in somebody, a specialist with wolves, brought them into MPC and got them to talk to all the animators. Brought in a specialist on tigers to talk to the entire animation class about, you know, how they move and why. And it's great because then when you go through, when you are searching for footage that maybe helps you animate your shot, you understand why they're doing what they're doing, and it helps you also look for what you want to find. Because we kind of tasked the animators with figuring out what, you know, we would give them a shot, and we'd say, this shot is about this, and we need you to find a clip that represents that. You know, find something, a starting pose, a starting place. And then we go through and find a clip of a wolf that, you know, turns its head a certain way, makes it feel like it's really expressing or saying something. And, you know, this was also, you know, John Favreau was really on this page. He was really on the page of, I want to keep the movements as natural as possible across almost all the animals and not make them anthropomorphic. He was really against pushing too much human, things we know as definitely human into them. But he said, I still want them, obviously, to talk. They're speaking, speaking, you know, throughout the film, and how do we make that feel the right? You know, and he kind of, then he'd go and reference films that he felt worked better. For example, Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Funny enough, I don't know if you know this movie. His kids were watching it at the time. But he would make us watch that and say, look, I believe the dog is talking. And a lot of the reason is because 95% of the frame is real and they're just replacing the mouth. And at that point, you don't care as much if the mouth is perfectly lip-syncing every syllable. It's not as important. It's more important that the image looks real and that the movement of the animal looks real. And so that was what John really kind of stressed. So this approach ended up working really well for us, that we would find real movements and real behaviors and transpose them into what we needed for the performance. Here's another thing that's kind of interesting. It's a study of a walk and versus a run. And this drawing up here on the left is a good example of something that I've really been striving for in animation, because the typical animation rig is the one on the left. So where you basically have an IK control on the leg, and you can move the foot around, and the knee bends, and you never sense that there's any weight on it unless you animate it perfectly. And it's really hard because the knee is constantly, it's IK, it's constantly like that joint, constantly able to shift and move slightly. Even the slightest movement makes you feel like it's not supporting its weight. Even the slightest bend that's not working through the whole movement of the walk. And so if you look at the second example in the middle, it's kind of called an inverse pendulum. But it's really about when you walk, you're almost on stilts. You know, you walk and you kind of teeter, and your leg is a stilt, and it's solid, and it's strong, it's heavy, it's the muscles flex, and it supports the weight, and then it teeters to the next leg. And then it's allowed to bend and be free. And so when you're running, it's a very different system. It's the spring, you know, basically a spring dynamic. So a run is like your leg actually absorbs the shock and then pushes off again. So a rig that can do both, built for walking and built for running, is nice. Is the ideal to have. So if you look at this next example, it's kind of basically a previs rig that I built for to do Jungle Book, and it's kind of showing that sense of weight. You know, it's showing what I've always been lacking in a lot of quadrupeds and stuff, that the bones should lock, and then when they're locked, they kind of push the spine, everything else reacts. So it's not the, if you look at the actual controls, I don't know if it's going to loop. Yeah, it's looping. But if you look at the controls in the middle or in the hip, like, they're not moving that much. They're moving more on a spline. What's giving you the more sharper movement is the fact that the legs are locking correctly at the times they need to lock, and they're supporting the weight. And that's like a separate slider that's actually on the foot. So it's something I really wanted to push, and I showed this to MPC, and I said, I really want these controls in all the animals. And the rigger there, called named Ben Jones, phenomenal rigger, basically built this system into his controls at MPC, and they had we had a really good time of being able to make these animals move more realistic because of this. And then you can actually switch it off for run cycles and kind of animate more of a natural way. I don't know if you've seen this. This is actually really good. You know, we looked at this with John. It's something that's been viral on YouTube, and I'll play it, and then we'll talk about it. But it's really about, you know, finding a performance of a dog, like they did here, that they just shot the dog doing something, and then they realized what it might be saying or thinking, and they added those words into the dog's mouth, and you really start to believe it. So here we go.
Food. You know, I just couldn't stop thinking about it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I went to the fridge, and I opened up the meat drawer. You know what the meat drawer is, right?
Yeah. What was in there?
Well, I'll tell you what was in there. You know that bacon that's like maple? It's got maple flavor.
The maple kind, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Yeah.
I took that out, and I thought...
Yeah.
I know who would like that. Me. So I ate it.
Oh, no. You're kidding me.
Nope. Not kidding. You know, I also noticed there was some beef in there. Yeah, you know, steak, you know, juicy. Well, I ate that too. But I went back to the fridge just a few minutes ago, and I put something together really special. You're going to love this one. I took some chicken.
Yeah.
I put some cheese on it, and I covered it with...
Covered it with what?
I covered it with cat treats.
Yeah.
Then guess what?
What?
I gave it to the cat.
So it really became a good example of what John loved about, you know, natural movement, natural behavior that you kind of repurpose for what we need. So not pushing them in any way that makes them more human, but trying to see the humanity within them. And so, you know, it was, you know, if you look at the ears even throughout that clip, they're so good. Like the little ear movements and the subtlety of it really makes you feel like the animal's thinking the words they put in his mouth. And let me go on to a few others. So the limited jaw flap was something that John really liked too. He, you know, obviously he said we got to do a little more than that because you don't always believe he's saying those words. But he said he didn't want to over articulate the lips and make it feel like the lips are moving in an unnatural way to an animal. And so as long as we have the same muscles, the muscles they could do, as long as we get close enough, John would be happy. And I think it was a good choice because anytime we kind of, there was a couple shots we had over enunciated, and John right away would react to it and be like, I'm just staring at the lips. I don't want to be looking at the lips of the animal. I want to see the performance. I want to see the eyes. But now I'm looking at the lips because they're moving a lot. And I said, okay. So, you know, we just had to hit specific moments of the word, specific syllables to help tie it together. And a lot of times it worked really well. Here's a clip of Icky.
My leaf is my pebble, my leaf. Touches my rock, two rocks, three rocks, peace rock, peace rock.
So if I, you know, play it again, if you watch I don't know if you watched this one or that one, but watch the upper one, it's really the reference we took, you know, and the speed and style of movement, we really wanted to be natural to the animal, but make it repurposed for, let me do it on, watch the upper right, the green.
My leaf. Is my pebble, my leaf. My pebble, my pebble, my pebble, my leaf. No one touches. three rocks, peace rock, peace rock.
So this, we use this kind of purpose throughout the film to kind of bring more of a naturalistic to all the animals, you know. It's it really was part of what helped Jungle Book become what it was. I mean, that plus coupled with the render technique, the way they rendered fur and the realistic rendering. I can show you the final right now.
My leaf. This is my pebble, my leaf. My pebble, my leaf. No one touches my rock, two rocks, three rocks. Peace rock. Peace rock.
So, yeah. we took that kind of style. And here's a particular example. This is one character, Baloo, in the movie that John kind of gave us a bit more leeway with. We originally started with, before I show you this clip, we originally started with the same technique of finding bear clips that would relate to the motion. But a lot of times bears are very kind of lazy, and they're funny a lot, but they don't typically move their heads very quickly. They don't express that much. We couldn't find movements that kind of represented what we needed. So John said we really have to try to make it feel like Bill Murray is in the bear. And, you know, so he really gave us a little more freedom to kind of look at what Bill does, particularly in, this is particularly in his own take of the film, but in his voice recording. But we also went back to other Bill Murray movies and looked at how he reacts, his specific expressions that we liked. We kind of used those in different parts of the movie as well. And then we also used other acting reference from John, but here's an example. I'll just let it loop a little.
Females do sting. Just put some honey on those. Females do sting. Just put some honey on those. Females do sting. Just put some honey on those.
And see, if you watch, I'll let it play without the sound. But if you watch, like, you know, trying to hit little details of making it feel like a bear still in terms of how jowly and flappy the lips are, but having a little bit of Bill Murray, like it's slightly asymmetry, stuff that you might see in a real bear as well. And then the eyes, obviously, we were pushing a little further, Bill Murray. It's definitely not bear eyes. But what's funny is when the fur is on there, a lot of this disappears. So it was another one of our biggest challenges. So like the brow, for example, you know, being up and crunched and worried and all that sort of stuff, it kind of goes away when the fur is there. So you miss a lot of it. And I'll kind of show you the next. So here's that shot again, but whole body. Oops. Sorry. I don't know what happened. 1 second.
Males do sting. Just put some honey on those. Females do sting.
Oh.
Just put some honey on those. Females do sting. Just put some honey on those. Females do sting. Just put some honey on those.
And this, I mean, this, let me go back to it, sorry. It's another example of
females do sting.
Try to stop.
Just put
it.
Some honey.
Something else I agree, you know, I do a lot in animation is, you know, this is an animation pass, and nowadays you can actually do kind of lighting, a little rough lighting, and now it's even getting better with, we're just talking about Unity tools and stuff like that. But to get a sense of light and get a sense of shadow and highlights in the eyes is so big for a director. They really, you know, if before, you know, 5 years ago, we were showing a lot of renders of for animation pass and showing it to a director without any sense of light, seeing a play blast and gray shaded and asking them to make calls on performance. And it's really, it's almost impossible, I find. And I think, you know, even those little highlights in the eyes, even on a play blast, is really, really important to telling whether this character is working, if I want more eye movement in there, if the eyes are open enough. Even the shadow of the eye, lid over the eye, you know, getting a sense of that already is so important. And so I always try to push that in any show I do. I'd say we've got to show at least this quality of animation. It helps us down the road, because when the director finally sees it rendered, it'll be the first time they see something looking more realistic, and then they react to the performance. Well, it's not strong enough, or it's not subtle enough, or it's not, you know, cute enough, or, you know. And I think at this stage you want to be making those calls and not waste all the render time. And here's the final.
Fe- Females do sting. Just put some honey on those. Females do sting.
So you can see a lot of it's lost in the fur.
Honey on those. Females.
And even the eyes, you know, you can see the difference, the feeling of the subtlety or the expression is, it's a challenge, you know, that this sort of movie, and that's why one of the reasons why we ended up pushing Baloo even further. A lot of shots we pushed him even further than this to get more expression and more bill that we felt more in the animation, and we want to get it even more into the final render. Here's an example of, again, timing out, looking at the different walks. So looking at performance again of, you know, trying to fit it into what the attitude and the feeling of this shot was. And I think here's the final.
I suppose you know why I've come.
The man cub has left the jungle.
Here's another example of the way, it's a little how-to. That's what we shot. Kid is a very good actor. He's walking on a turntable. Sorry, I don't have the audio with this. Yeah. Here's another kind of put together scene. This is what we shot for the hug. If you watch here, see the way his hand is gray? That's because it's digital. I'll show you that one more time. But his whole arm and everything was digital. And one more, just to show the facial controls we had on the animals. This has that's what a typical kind of basic rig looked like. I didn't talk too much about the facial rigs, but they were quite good. And a very similar process as Avatar to try to get very naturalistic kind of thinner skin feeling around the eyes, and then a little bit thicker skin feeling around the muzzle, around the lips. It's all about being very careful with how you move those shapes and how you do multiple shapes together and how it pulls the skin and tightens the skin. Here's one more. I know we're running out of time, so I'm finishing. But the tricky part of this is, you know, that's what the kid had to act with in running up and grabbing a... Here's one from Weta. It's a good example also that we did of Baloo throughout. So if you see John Favreau on the left, Bill Murray on the lower left, and then lower right, a Bill Murray from one of his films, and another expression. And on the upper right is the animator from Weta. And so, you know, because we didn't have any of the actors doing exactly the movement that he needed, the animator actually ended up trying to put it all together, and he did a really good job.
Am I in the right monkey temple? Oh my gosh, is that King Louie? Am I in the right monkey temple? Oh my gosh, is that King Louie? Am I in?
So, I mean, what's cool about this is I think the animator is really good at channeling Bill, and I kind of use that as an example to show to other animators at NPC, saying that, you know, yeah, basically, Todd Labonte is the animator who did that. And I've known him since Avatar. He was one of my leads on Avatar down at Weta. He's an amazing animator down there. And he did a really good job of, like, thinking how would Bill do it if Bill was, you know, with the whole head wobbling stuff. Very kind of channeling early Bill Murray days. And here's the...
Am I in the right monkey temple? Oh, my gosh. Is that King Louie?
So, and here's a... This character was a bit...
I am the king of the Badalag. Call me Louis.
not looking so good, but